Hi, welcome to the Scrap Engineering Chronicles. This time around, we're going to be building this guy. This is a heavy-duty hauling rack for my pickup truck. It's meant primarily for hauling my canoe, but it's also used for hauling lumber, ladders, and piping, and so on. It's constructed entirely from scrap material. In my case, I happen to have these pieces from an earlier version of the rack I built. The tricky part is going to be cutting the pipe that acts as your cross pieces, and we'll get to that probably in part two. Even if you have to buy everything from scratch, you're still looking at maybe $60 in materials, and you'll have a rack that you can literally exceed the hauling weight of your vehicle with. I have in the past overloaded my truck to where it was bottoming out on the springs. So this thing, very rugged, very simple to build, very inexpensive, and very, very useful. This time around, I want to do a project that is something. It's actually something you can put together in a single Saturday afternoon once you've got the materials, presuming you don't finish it, meaning don't paint it or varnish it. I'm going to strongly suggest that you paint it and or varnish it simply because it's going to be exposed to the elements from time to time. So what are we going to be building? Hauling rack for my pickup truck. And it's something that's very, very simple to put together. It's based on a design that I came up with about, 11, 12 years ago. And I built this on a weekend for hauling my canoe. And I needed a way to load and unload my canoe by myself. And I've got a big, it's a 16-footer. It's something you can carry by yourself, but you can't easily load it onto a vehicle by yourself. And that was kind of annoying. So I decided to fix the problem. Well, it worked great, but I was a little bit stupid. I'd never put any coating or lacquer or varnish or anything on the hauling rack, and I took to storing it outside, leaned against the fence or the garage, and eventually the weather and bugs got to it. And I wasn't happy with some parts of the design. It wasn't easy to put together. It had all these complicated little hinge bits and things. So I decided it was time to build a new one. So I sat down and sketched out a new design, and that's what I'm going to show you how to build. What are you going to need? Well, tools is very, very simple for this one. You're going to need a circular saw, and while you don't have to have it, it would be helpful if you had the circular saw jig that I constructed, or something similar. You could also use a speed square, but I find this actually works better than the speed square. The other thing you're going to need for power tools is some kind of drill. Now, it doesn't have to be battery operated. It can be a corded drill. Pretty much that's it for tools. The only other thing you're going to need is materials. You're going to need some glue, wood glue. You're going to need some screws. I use drywall screws, 1 1/4 inch, I think they are, drywall screws. Just a small box of those will work. You're also going to need some lumber. If you're buying all of this, you're going to need 4 8-foot chunks of 2x4. Okay. Then you're also going to need about 12 pieces of what I call stubbies. Now, what are stubbies? Stubbies is stuff like this, where you've got like a 2-footer or a 3-footer. If you've got a bunch of like stubbies like this to make some of the cross brace pieces, that's fine. If you don't, if you're having to buy lumber, my recommendation is don't buy 8-foot 2x4s, buy some 10-footers. So if you buy 5, would that be enough? Probably. 5 10-foot 2x4s, and if you have a couple of scraps, you're good to go. The only other piece you're going to need that you almost certainly will have to buy is some piping. Now, I'm reusing the piping that I built for, or put together for, my original canoe rack. And it consists, these two pieces of pipe are essentially the load-bearing surface that your canoe rides on. There's one in front of the bed of the truck and one at the back rear of the bed of the truck. Those pieces consist of a piece of 1 inch, you can see it, this galvanized pipe. Get this at your home center. And you'll need one 10-foot length of that. And you will need 1 10-foot length of 1 1/4 inch PVC. And the PVC acts like a sleeve or a skid bearing, right? So when you slide your canoe up onto your rack, it slides across this plastic and doesn't chew up the gunnels of your canoe. Or, like in my case, I use it for hauling ladders, I use it for hauling lumber, piping and stuff. So whatever you want just skids across this PVC really nicely. The only other thing you may have to buy are some stainless steel bolts and hardware. This is I think a 1 1/2 or 1 3/4 inch stainless bolt with a stainless nut, washer, and lock washer. And you'll need one for each end. of the two pieces of pipe. And this just acts like a keeper to keep the PVC from sliding off. So with no further ado, let me get started and let's make a rack. Like 73, I may cut that a half inch short or so. And just to make sure that the canoe clears the top of the truck, about 46 inches tall with a top slot of about 2 inches, that ought to be good. I just cut the first 73 inch lengthwise piece that'll fit lengthwise in the bed of the truck. I'm about to cut the second one, and I'm looking at this piece of lumber, and something to keep in mind, since this doesn't have to be pretty, where these knots don't make any difference, I want to make sure that I use as many knots in the piece of wood that I'm going to use in the project as possible. That way my offcut piece will be as clean as possible, because maybe a future project I will need a straighter unmarked piece. So again, I'm trying to keep all the knots and rough edges that I can. The only thing I have to watch for is, since I'm putting a half lap joint, that I'm not going to end up with a cut in the middle of a knot, trying to make a half lap joint on a weak knot. But it looks like I'll be okay. So time to measure and make that
cut. I cut these at 73 inches long because that's the length of the bed of the truck. These guys are 46 inches tall. This is going to be one of the verticals that holds the lengthwise rails. And the way these are going to work, I'm going to create a half lap joint approximately like this. So we're going to end up cutting a dado here and a rabbit on the end of the lengthwise 2x4. That will give us a very, very strong joint. So I'm going to go ahead and do the rabbit on the end of the two lengthwise pieces, and then I'm gonna have to look at the sketches I made and figure out where to put the dado on the verticals. There is going to be, again, the half lap joint here, so I need to cut a rabbet. To mark the depth of the rabbet on the board, I'm just gonna use a scrap and make sure that's kind of squared up with the edge there. Draw a line on the other side. Everything in here is gonna be a waste cut. I'm gonna wanna cut to half the thickness of the 2x4, so I've got to set the depth for about 3/4 of an inch. If I'm off a little bit, it doesn't matter too much for this project, because this is all salvaged and rough lumber, and it's meant to be something that can be put together with the construction grade lumber and some of the worst looking stuff that you might get at your home center. And this will be waste as well. There's a second set of uprights that are used to lock in the horizontal bracers, and those are placed at about 16 inches in, and this is where we're going to make a dado for these small braces. Now this is 20 inches, so that's easier to work with. I've got to drill a series of holes that you'll see in a later step, but I've kept it at 20. I'll cut all the holes and the insets, and then I'll rip it in half. So since this is one of the pieces I'm using, let me draw a line at my 16, and I'll cut, mark the other side, and so then I will cut this out again to half the depth of the 2x4, and I've got to do a similar cut on the opposite side of the board. Time to do our first cut, and then I will do a second set of cuts on the other lengthwise support, and then we'll move on to the next step. In this next section, I'm simply measuring out 8 pieces of the stubby's 21 inches in length. That number is a little bit arbitrary. Somewhere between 20 and, say, 23 inches would have been fine. But the shortest stubby I had was, I think, 21.5 inches. So I cut off that to give myself good edges to work with, and then just use that as a base. So whatever you pick, just cut 8 of them down to the same length. And these are going to be used on the 4 cross pieces that will interlock with the vertical uprights.
One of the things for this project, for this hauling rack, you're probably going to end up with a lot of these little off-cut ends. Normally, guys will just chuck these. Don't. We're going to go ahead and use these, and you'll see what these are for. Not so much on this project, but on the add-on part 2 project that's coming after this one. So get a little bucket or something and hang on to these, because you'll end up needing a lot of little pieces of 2x4. Once you've got your 8 pieces cut at 21 inches long, the way these are going to work, these are going to form part of the cross pieces that run along the width of the truck bed. And we're basically going to create kind of a, I can't think of the name of the joint, but it's basically a half lap joint where this will lock down in and there'll be a matching notch. You want to leave enough meat here so that you've got some wood strength for the lock. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to come in, let's call it 2 inches. And knowing that the 2x4s are actually about 1.5 inches, I don't want a whole lot of slop on this. So I'm going to mark it at 1.5 inches, and I'll show you how to cut the inset. And then if we have to come back and trim this a little bit bigger, we can. Trick on it is you only want to go to half the width. So 2x4s are usually 3.5. A little bit of math, that works out to be to 1¾. Strike a line. And then where I measured 1.5 inches from that. And then this is the waste area that I want to remove. Now I may end up removing a little bit off this edge if it turns out my cross piece that this is going to be locking down into is a bit thicker than 1.5 inches, but we can always shave that off later. What I'm going to do is drill a couple holes here in the corner. Then you can cut this either using a jigsaw. I'm going to use the bandsaw because I've got one and it'll make quick work of this. But essentially we're going to step and repeat this on all 8 of the 21 inch pieces. Now this doesn't have to be super precise, but I'm just going to mill out these corners using the Forstner, and then that'll make it easy to get in there and then make the turn with the bandsaw. If you're using a jigsaw, you may want to do the same kind of thing rather than trying to make the curve while you're cutting the wood. And there you go. Transfer to the other side. We're going to go ahead and do the cut. Okay, and there we go. Okay, why did I measure and then cut one piece as opposed to measuring all of the pieces and doing them? The point being, when you've got a lot of operations and it's a step and repeat kind of deal, it's just easier if you go ahead and cut one and then use that as your master template. Look at what kind of crap wood you're getting. You don't want this sort of thing on the end where you're going to have this notch. You need some strength in the wood. I'm going to go ahead and do my layout. Right, so I've finished cutting all 8 of my hook pieces that are going to go across the width of the bed, and that's all I'm going to do on this for now because I need to do some other cutting operations. So I've got 4 vertical uprights that are 36 inches long. These need to have a notch cut on the bottom end that is going to match this, so you get a full, again, it's kind of a half lap joint on edge. So I'm going to find the center and mark and cut that out, and then I should be able to use that as a template on the other three vertical uprights. There's a second operation that needs to happen on this. These pieces, which I'll show you how to make in a little bit, are designed such that when the vertical upright sits vertically upright in the bed of the truck, there needs to be a U-shaped notch cut here that these will sit down into. So what I'm going to do is find a center point, drill a maybe a 1 1/4 inch hole with a Forstner bit, and then join that and cut up to the top surface. The depth I picked kind of arbitrarily is to go down in so that the bottom of the channel is 3 inches down. So let me go ahead and do some measuring, and marking. Find that. All right, that is going to be for the center point on the Forstner bit that I used to drill the 1 1/4 inch hole here on this end, so that it's easier for me to work in there with the bandsaw and cut the notch, and then use this template to transfer to the other three verticals. I'm using the drill press. You could use a hand drill, battery drill, or a corded power drill. I'm using this because I have it. It makes the operation a little bit easier. Trying to wrestle, especially a Forstner bit this big, with a hand drill can get kind of tiring. So I'm using this because I have it, but I've done it before with bits even bigger than this with a hand drill. Just don't run them full speed. Make sure you've got your workpiece clamped really well. Make my cut. Okay, all four of the verticals are cut. Now it's time to just do a quick test fit. Make sure these are gonna... Yep. Just like that. All right, so the long cross piece that runs the length of the bed of the truck is going to be half lapped onto two of these verticals, one in each corner. What I'm going to do is just set the top of that 12 inches down from the edge here. That piece will sit here. That's the only dado I have to cut in these verticals. Let me go ahead and mark these. I'm going to cut all of the dados and the rabbits in the lumber using this. This is basically a poor man's workmate. This was one of those Harbor Freight specials. I'm not real happy with it. It's nothing like a real workmate, but this does work. Leg guard out of the way. And the cap goes out in a hammer. Okay, I made a template piece. This is going to fit on the long cross member, and I'll show you where in the next segment. I need three more of these. Use this as a template, trace it out, cut them to length, and then machine the pieces in. But it helps if you turn on the power first. Okay, time to make the transfers.
An important point I need to make here is that my intention had been to cut these as 20-inch sections, meaning the two 10-inch pieces would be worked on as a single 20-inch, and that way you could easily cut the dados in each one using the circular saw and, say, a speed square. Then, after all the operations were done,
the milling operations, then you'd make a single cut down the middle and separate the two 10-inch sections from one another. That's really the only way you can make that kind of dado cut safely using a circular saw, is having a longer piece of wood. Given that I kind of screwed this up, I ended up having to cut these dados using the table saw, and that was simply for the sake of safety. These are too small to do this on it with the circular saw.
All right, time to drill and then put the dados in these. And now for some glue. Just rinse and repeat. All right, here we are towards the end of the afternoon. Got it assembled. The two side rails look like this, and they're placed in the bed of the truck. And if you've got your measurements right, you'll see that it comes right to the rear of the bed. On that side, right there. And you'll still be able to get your tailgate closed, which is the point. So essentially, now all I gotta do is wait for the glue to dry and finish assembling the cross pieces to give you an idea what that looks like. These and a center spanning piece. These are gonna go up here. Let me get this in place. Like so, all right? And then there's going to be a matching one on that side. And then there's going to be a solid piece in between. The reason I'm doing it in three sections is so that I can fine tune the width, and also so that I can use scrap pieces. I didn't have a lot of lumber that is full 6 or 8 foot. So if I make the cross pieces in three pieces, then I can use up the stubbies. But same thing goes here. Essentially, there'll be two cross pieces in the bed of the truck,
at the front and here at the back. And those will go in first. Those will get set in place first. And then once they're in, then those are going to lock in place and they will hold all of this upright. Holy crap, I just realized I made a huge mistake. Yep, forgot to take into account part of the bed of the truck. See, in the front, there's enough room for this piece to protrude past the vertical and for the vertical to be flat against the bed. Here at the back, that is not the case. Caught live on film, my stupidity. All right, I'm gonna have to rethink this. All right, I've got a solution. Here at the back, what I will do is modify the single cross piece here. So one small modification to these to chop this off right here. And we lose this piece and all is saved. So minor panic, but I can work around it. Okay, here's the advantage of having a three-piece setup. These are the two 21-inchers where I've trimmed the ends off, and now everything nestles tight against the bed. And then we place this piece in here, and what I'll do is I'm going to attach this I'm just going to put in some screws, I think. And in case I ever move this to a different truck that has a slightly different dimension on the bed, I can take the screws out, shift it down, and so on. These ones happen to be, these are 28 inches long, gave me enough overlap. I could get away with as little as about 25 inches and still have enough. The only thing they're there for is to keep the feet from kicking inwards. I don't know how well this is going to come out on the camera, but there is the 95% completed rack. Everything is done. Everything is screwed together. The glue has pretty much set. The only thing that is left is I've got to build some little keeper pieces here that will effectively keep the rod from sliding around. So once it sets down into these channels, taking turns in the truck, it won't come sliding off or out. It's the only thing I have left to do. I'll knock that together here in a little bit, but before I lose all of the light, I wanted to show you the final result. And again, you can see this is made, you can see the twist there. This is made for some pretty heinous salvage lumber. And so as long as you allow for some of the slop in the construction, you can deal with this kind of thing. And again, it's just sort of like Lincoln logs locked together. And that thing is, it is a sturdy tank, quite frankly. This is actually more rigid even than the original one that I had built a number of years ago. The other thing I've got to do is sand this. I'm not going to do a fancy job on it, but I do want to sand it down. It's got a lot of pretty nasty edges here. Once it's sanded down, I've got all the corners knocked off and things are round and nice and friendlier, then I'm going to go ahead and probably paint it exterior oil-based. It really penetrates and it seals extremely well. And given that this is going to see some abuse, seems like a wise thing to do. I've about had enough for today. This is something, if you just have all the materials, you can, in fact, knock this out in a single day. It's easily done on a weekend. But it comes apart in, what is this, 6 wooden pieces and then the 2 rails. And it should all store flat, sit flat against the wall in the garage. And it is beastly strong. And it doesn't weigh that much. You know, so it doesn't take away much from the hauling capacity of the truck. I mean, I can reach over here and one hand I can hoist it in the air. I'll come back and I'll show you the finish work with the cap pieces here. And then it is time for the second truck project video.
which is related to this, and actually will work in conjunction with it. Doesn't have to. It can either work with this or be an independent project. I'm not going to spoil that yet.